You have started a screen share.
All right, everybody. I'm going to try an abbreviated version of the same lecture to make sure it's recorded and available. The real tension in pharmaceuticals is that it's the one area that we as patients and consumers feel financially the most. If you look at where the money of your health insurance premiums go, not total healthcare spending, if you just look at where your premiums go when you pay your health insurance premiums, about a quarter go to prescription drugs. And also for people who have chronic conditions, about half the country has a chronic condition. The regular trips to the pharmacy mean that you feel the cost of pharmaceuticals more than you feel hospital stays or office and clinic visits or even doctor services. Especially with hospital stays, even though that's where a third of total healthcare spending goes, once you hit a certain point, a limit, then you don't pay any more for hospital care, but you're always feeling prescription drug costs. And of course, a graph that will not surprise you is that per spending per person for prescription drugs, the United States feels the most. And it's in the 1990s that prescription drugs really took off, because this is also the period where we had some really brand new expensive biological drugs and drugs that do enhance the quality of our life, but they come at a cost. And then if you look at a lot of drug companies' profit margins relative to other kinds of companies like Disney, Verizon, Coke, General Electric, American Airlines, drug company profit margins tend to be some of the biggest in the corporate sector. Among all the other areas of the economy, drug companies tend to have the biggest profit margins. Part of that is explained by the fact that it's riskier. Drug development is riskier than other areas of things that you can produce. Drugs are just, you can make a lot of money producing drugs, you can lose a lot of money. And the vast majority of drugs that are researched lose money. They don't work, they don't get past inspection, they don't get past clinical trials. But most drug companies, it's the minority of the chemical compounds that they develop ever become profitable. And so these are just some slides that show this is the conundrum, this is the tension that we face with regulating pharmaceuticals, which is if drug companies don't make about 15 to 20% profit margins, as all results have shown, if they don't make these kinds of profit margins, they would just go into a different line of business. They'd make cars, or they develop oil and gas, or they produce media. If you had profit margins of 5% or less, most drug companies would just close shop and do something else. So you have to, in some way, shape, or form, you have to allow them to make profit margins that are closer to banks and other parts of the economy. Otherwise, they just wouldn't do it. And this is just the most recent New England Journal of Medicine analysis that showed that that's about what pharmaceuticals' profit margins are, about 17-18%, which is about what technology companies make. And it's more than consumer goods and materials and communications and industrials and energy and the healthcare sector overall. It's just the way pharmaceuticals are. And in part, that's because look at the things that they have developed over the years, vaccines in the last 100 years that have basically doubled life expectancy. Bayer aspirin 100 years ago, we never had anything for pain relief before Bayer. Insulin discovered in 1921 in Canada. As I mentioned before, I wouldn't even show you photos of what patients who had type 1 diabetes, how they suffered until insulin came out. It's horrific. And now people with type 1 diabetes can live a fairly normal life with normal life expectancy. It's harder, but they can do it. Antibiotics is discovered in 1928 after World War I, and then it's mass produced around World War II. And I imagine everybody in this class has taken on antibiotics at some point. You take them for granted, but before they existed, cholera, pneumonia, tuberculosis killed people by the millions. And antibiotics made those conditions treatable. Drugs for psychosis, before they came out in the 1950s, there was really nothing you could do for people with severe mental illness except just get them to hospitals removed from society. Contraceptives we'll cover next month when we get to women's health. Before oral contraception was made available in 1961, a lot of colleges didn't accept women. Most of the professions in this country did not have any path for women to be in them. And it's a total night and day change of human existence that after contraception comes out, feminism is enabled and empowered to allow women to have all the same options that men do when they can control the number and the timing of children. For all of human history, women couldn't do that and hence were trapped with very limited options. Oncology chemotherapy drugs are developed in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, and they're ongoing now with immunotherapy drugs. But until these drugs came out, a cancer diagnosis was a terminal diagnosis. There wasn't much you could do for you. Statins for heart care. For again, if you look at the death rate from heart disease, it's come down significantly in part because of statins that people can take as a pill. Many, many of Americans and people around the world suffer from all kinds of autoimmune diseases that are at their core about inflammation. And now in the last 2-3 decades, anti-inflammatories have made their lives so much better quality and given them so many more options to live a normal life. Antiretrovirals came out in the mid-1990s. Before that, if you got diagnosed with HIV, you were advised to put your affairs in order, get your will ready, because you could not survive. Now, people still get this, unfortunately. The virus still exists. It's still transmitted. But with antiretrovirals, you can keep it in check and live a reasonably normal life. These are all because people pour their lives into drug discovery, and it's life transforming. The question is, can we afford all of it? And this is just a shout out to all the people out there, many of the students who are watching this, who spend inordinate amounts of time in the lab. There are huge payoffs and improvements to life from it. I won't show this clip. You all can click on this and look at the discovery of penicillin, but every person should know the extraordinary story of how penicillin was accidentally discovered in 1928 by a doctor who had served in World War I and had seen, as has been true for all of human history until World War II, that more soldiers died of the infections from the wounds than from the wounds themselves. That's been true since human beings have been at war. And Sir Alexander Fleming is the doctor who discovered penicillin in 1928, but he wasn't a biochemist, so he didn't know how to mass produce it. Howard Florey and Ernest Chain later on discovered ways of mass producing it during World War II, and they all got the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 1945. These are the drugs that came out in the 1950s that completely changed severe mental illness. Lithium came out as an accidental discovery in Australia in 1949. Google the discovery of that. Amazing story. It wasn't approved in the United States until 1970 because lithium is a chemical compound that has to be handled very carefully. Too little does nothing for you. Too much can be damaging to organs, so often it's done on an inpatient basis, but it's a great mood stabilizer. Thorazine, the first antipsychotic drug ever to exist, was literally taken out to mental hospitals where people were basically sequestered for their entire lives because they were not able to live with psychosis in their societies. They were given an injection of chlorpromazine or by the trade name Thorazine, and they could go home and live their lives. Meprobamate, known by the trade name Miltown, came out in 1955 for severe anxiety, and it became the drug that allowed people to manage anxiety pharmaceutically for the first time instead of with alcohol. Haldol, the second antipsychotic, came out to join Thorazine in 1957. These two drugs are still used to treat psychosis, and they are life-saving drugs. This drug is special to me. Imipramine, known by the trade name Tofranil, came out in 1958, the first antidepressant that people could take to manage depression. And my grandfather, his life was made possible by this drug. He was a radiologist in Nashville. To my knowledge, one of the first radiologists to introduce radiology to the city of Nashville, and wrestled his whole life with depression, mild to moderate depression. This drug is what enabled him to have a family, to have a profession, to have the semblance of a normal life. And I'm here because this drug enabled him to live. Librium came out, known by the trade name Valium. Everybody's heard of Valium, another anti-anxiety drug. And for people who wrestle with anxiety, especially people who are have moments of or acute episodes of anxiety before surgeries, before major transitions, major episodes of trauma, Valium is a very valuable drug. It has, like meprobamate and other drugs that are psychiatric in nature, it has abuse potential because it can be addictive, but used correctly and with doctor supervision, a real help to people who struggle in life. The pill is not a psychiatric medication. I just put it in here to show you along this lineage of pills coming out and other medications. This really helped people that before that had no pharmaceutical options at all. 1961, methylphenidate, known by the trade name Ritalin, came out. It's now used to treat ADHD, but when it first came out, it was used for older people who had severe narcolepsy, which means that they can't stay awake. They all of a sudden will just collapse in fatigue, and it's, of course, a very serious condition. And then they started using it, as is often the case. They just tried drugs for different populations who have needs, and they started trying Ritalin as an alternative to amphetamines for children with severe ADHD in the 1970s, and they found that it worked as well with less side effects. We'll cover this next month. The pill came out in 1961, and really, for all intents and purposes, there's a pre-1961 life, society, civilization, and then there is a life, the modern life after 1961, when women can control their fertility. And we'll have a greater appreciation of that when we get to that weekly topic. This drug, Prozac, came out in December of 1987. I remember it so clearly. And then it was basically released to the public in January of 1988. This was a breakthrough drug. It was not accidentally discovered. They were looking for a drug to treat depression that had less side effects and could be used for people who had less severe forms of depression, mild to moderate depression, of which there are millions of Americans who have mild to moderate depression. Prozac came out in 1988, and it created a complete paradigm change in the pharmaceutical industry, and I'll tell you how it happened. Prozac was the drug that shifted the people's thinking in this way. Up until Prozac, the thinking was, if a person was sick in whatever way you measured sickness, you'd put them on a medicine like Prozac, they would get better, and then you would get them off the medicine because you weren't supposed to take a pill or take medicine just when you got better. You're supposed to get off of it. Peter Kramer was a psychiatrist at Brown who treated patients with depression. And of course, he tried Prozac when it was a new drug because a lot of his patients weren't responding to the other medications. He put them on Prozac. They got better. He took them off Prozac. And then a short time thereafter, his patients returned to the office and said, please put me back on Prozac. This drug makes me feel better and I have a better life. I'm a better spouse. I'm a better student, a better employee. I'm happier on this drug. And at first he resisted and said, that's not really the way we think of medications. You're on a medication when you're sick. And then when you get better, we take you off of it. His patients changed his mind and persuaded him that there are instances in which people's lives can be made better permanently. And it can be done with pharmaceuticals. And Prozac was an example to the drug companies of the money you could make if you developed what they called lifestyle drugs that treated human conditions and treated them for the rest of their life. They'd be on a maintenance medication for decades. And Prozac was the drug that showed the profit potential of drugs that people would take indefinitely. Which leads to the article I assigned to you all on the potential, extraordinary potential, therapeutic potential of psychedelic drugs. And drugs like LSD, psilocybin, mushrooms, hallucinogenic mushrooms, for treatment of people who have severe problems with addiction, trauma, end-of-life anxiety. And Michael Pollan is a famous writer who usually writes about food. And then he decided, as a natural extension of writing about food, he would write about the potential to use psychedelics to treat people who have not found relief or improvement for severe experiences with addiction, depression, anxiety, trauma, PTSD. Let me show you a clip of how he explains this.
I guess the biggest misconception people have about psychedelics is that these are drugs that make you crazy. And we now have evidence that that does happen sometimes. But in many more cases, these are drugs that can make you sane or more sane. If you ask people about what psychedelics or LSD, they're going to think about the 60s. Timothy Leary, this flamboyant psychology professor, studying psilocybin and LSD, and then telling everybody they should take
it. I'm very glad to be discredited. I don't want credibility. I want incredibility.
The drugs kind of escaped the laboratory and were embraced by the counterculture and proved to be very disruptive to society. So you had this full-scale moral panic that eventually doomed the research. But what people don't know is that that 60s episode was really one small chapter in a much longer story. Psychedelic drugs of one kind or another have been used by different societies for thousands of years. If you compare mental health care with any other branch of medicine, infectious disease, cardiology, oncology, there have been very few achievements. Mental health treatment has not lengthened the human lifespan. So we need some new thinking. We need some new ideas, and psychedelics may well be that new idea. There's a really exciting field of research underway right now looking at psychedelics, especially psilocybin, the ingredient in magic mushrooms, to help people deal with mental illness of various kinds. Addiction, depression, obsession, and the fear and anxiety that surrounds a terminal diagnosis. And the feeling among the scientists is that these chemicals allow us to essentially reboot the brain. All those kind of deep grooves that lock us into patterns of both thought and behavior are dissolved and temporarily suspended in a way that allows us to break those patterns. We're now in a different world. The adults now, many of them have experience of psychedelics. They're not going to react in such a panicky way, I don't think. Many of the people in charge of our institutions, probably regulators at the FDA, people at the American Psychiatric Association, they have personal experience of psychedelics, and they're, I think, going to bring a more rational attitude toward them. I learned that there is a thriving underground of psychedelic therapists. These are serious professionals, but they're doing something legal. And I was able to find my way into this community, and after interviewing several of them, I found a couple people I felt comfortable enough to entrust my mind to. This isn't doctors giving you a pill and sending you out into the world. You are, for a period of 4 or 5 hours, in a room that's decorated like a kind of cozy den or study. You're lying down on a couch, you have eye shades on, and headphones, which are playing a very carefully curated playlist to make you go inside, to have an internal experience. And you're with two guides at all times. Some people are put in touch with childhood trauma. Some people have encounters with death. It can be very dark. But with the help of the guides, you use that material and try to understand it. So after the session, you always come back the next day and have what's called a period of integration, where the guides, who are therapists, trained therapists, help you interpret what happened and figure out ways to put it to good use in changing your life. My best journey was this a fairly high dose psilocybin journey that I had with a guide. What was stunning about it was I did have an experience of complete ego dissolution. I reached a point where I myself just kind of fell apart into these little pieces of paper, post-its, that just got scattered to the wind, and I saw myself. And I know that sounds weird. Who's the I that saw myself? But there is this split in consciousness that happens. But I saw myself scattered to the wind, but I was all right with it. And I learned a really important lesson in that moment, which is that I'm not identical to my ego.
So, I don't know. I mean, you guys, the more you read about this, the more you see it has real potential to help people who are suffering and don't find any relief with other medications. They still have this stigma associated with them, that they were used in recreational ways that are mind-altering. So it's interesting to see how, you know, this inexorable need to find other medications and options that can help people bring us back to things that have been around for a long time. I've done surveys of previous classes about would you take a pharmaceutical to treat mild depression or mild anxiety, not full-blown clinical depression or anxiety, but just, you know, would you take a pill to feel better and do better in life? And the results I found was the last class was 100 said yes, 50 said no. The yes, for the reasons you might expect, you know, you only get one life. Why not try to enjoy it more or suffer less or be more effective? The no group is worried about slippery slope and trying to find non-pharmaceutical alternatives to deal with depression and mild depression and mild anxiety. And there's no right or wrong answer per se. People weigh this their whole life about, you know,
Thomas Stewart has left the meeting.
What is the right way to handle the difficulties of life? But these drugs being out there raise these questions of, you know, where's the clinical dividing line between what's appropriate and you should take medication and it's the right thing to do versus, you know, there's other ways maybe in non-pharmaceutical to manage life's challenges. I don't have the right answer. Nobody per se does, but people have these debates all the time.
Thomas Stewart has joined the meeting.
Another area where this issue becomes more touchy is of things like attention deficit disorder, which the consensus in science is that, hey, Thomas, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. This is my second try of doing this, so I don't know how well this is going, but I'm trying to tape it. So you're welcome to join along, but I'll also just drop it into the to collab later on, too. You don't have to stick around for this.
All right, sounds good. Thank you.
Take care, okay?
You too.
If you look at the stimulant sales in the last two decades, this is a really big growth in ADHD prescription drugs. And the
Thomas Stewart has left the meeting.
The number of adults, I mean, there really can't be this many more cases of ADHD because nothing has dramatically changed that would trigger a pandemic of ADHD. But drugs that can help one population can help a population that doesn't have ADHD. And that's what we found with ADHD drugs is that they tend to help most people's concentration and attention span. So there's a temptation in these pharmaceuticals to use them beyond the population for whom they're primarily designed. This is Keith Connors, the godfather of ADHD, who spent the 50s, 60s, and 70s doing the hard scientific studies to show that there were children with ADHD, and they did respond well to these drugs. And towards the end of his life, he died a couple of years ago, he was distressed and concerned by this growth of the number of sales and the number of people on drugs that he didn't think were necessarily supposed to be on them. And if you look at the variation across the country of states that have a high use of ADHD drugs and states that have a low use, you realize that there are other factors that determine sometimes when people use these drugs, and they're not always scientific factors. Oftentimes they're marketing. You see this kind of marketing primarily in the United States, where advertising drugs directly to the public is permissible. In most countries, you are only allowed to advertise pharmaceuticals to clinicians and medical journals. But in 1997, we lifted those restrictions, and now you give this child medication and he's no longer a monster. He's doing well in school. He has friends. You can see why there's a temptation to use drugs in non-medically specified ways. There's a Netflix documentary, and I just will show you the trailer because I know you guys are going to have more access to Netflix in the coming months. But it just shows what happens at schools where access to ADHD drugs becomes almost not the norm, but it becomes widespread.
I learned about ADD after being on the medication. I didn't know what it was. All I knew was for school.
And then when I got here and I was like, holy shit, everybody takes Adderall. Everyone. I take it right when I wake up. It takes about 40 minutes to kick in. I start to sweat. My heart accelerates. My handwriting got neater. I thought that was so cool.
My mind came alive. My body felt alive. Works like a bang.
Adderall, warning, side effects may include being awesome at everything. Every generation has found a different way to try to enhance their performance. Now, in this case, it has been ADHD drugs. This ain't new.
It's not like a glass of wine or a joint or any way that people use to decompress. I really see it as a supplement, as a tool.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
So then you're primed that a pill is going to give me what I want.
I felt this like mounting pressure from work to start using my prescription.
That says something about our culture right now.
It makes me kind of depressed.
I have meds for that.
Everyone has a little ADD. No, we have distractions, but not everyone has a brain that functions like somebody's with ADHD.
I wouldn't say that I'm happy to have Adderall, but I'm happy that Adderall is an option for you.
There are cardiovascular risks, psychotic episode. You wouldn't wish that on your worst enemy.
I've got everything I wanted, and there's no way any of that would have been possible without the medication.
The perfect employee is somebody that doesn't say no. There is a culture of you do stay up 16 hours for 7 days straight. I've had a seizure from exhaustion.
You want to be beautiful and you want to have amazing grades, and Adderall just sort of sews it all up for you.
Adderall, the drug of our time.
This focus on material progress and productivity, what's the cost of that? Is that a cost we're willing to live with?
I know this is an issue on college campuses, and some colleges have added it to their honor code statement that illicit use, non-prescribed use of these drugs is an honor code violation. I've even had debates in class, and one of the sticking points is how would you enforce that? But it is an issue on college campuses. And when I did that survey on would you take a pharmaceutical to treat mild depression or mild anxiety, I asked a follow-up on would you take a prescription product to do better on papers and tests in college, especially if other students were doing it. And the numbers were more or less reversed. 57 said yes, 93 said no. It's just an example, an interesting contrast about how we view what's bioethically appropriate in using medications. To get an academic advantage or a work advantage, no, we're less inclined to think that's okay. To just feel better and to suffer less, people are more okay with that. And I want to take a moment just to show you this graph that came out about a month ago from this emerging deaths of despair study, Ann Case and Angus Deaton at Princeton. They have a book coming out. When they controlled for without a college degree, with a college degree, this last decade and a half phenomenon of deaths of despair is almost solely concentrated in people who have not had the privilege of going to college. Those who've gone to college, there's not been a big uptick in deaths from alcohol, drugs, and suicide. It's concentrated almost solely in those who have not been able to go to college, which is really striking. You know, the number of deaths of despair with college education unchanged, without college, it suggests that, you know, it used to be you didn't have to have a college degree to have a decent life, a good life. But things have changed with the gig economy and offshoring, manufacturing, and the economic life being more competitive in some ways, that college used to be, a means to some better opportunities. Now it's almost as if you just have to go to college to avoid some of the more negative outcomes, including opioid abuse. And these deaths of despair were spearheaded by the release of OxyContin about a decade and a half ago and promoted by the drug companies. I include this case study of OxyContin and fentanyl, and then once they clamped down on that finally, they already had all these addicts who then switched to heroin. But this is an example where the drug company's desire for profit maximization has led to an epidemic of overdoses of what's basically at the chemical level heroin. And there's another, as you would imagine, there is a great Netflix documentary that I highly recommend called The Pharmacist, which does an exquisite job of
outlining. I'm Dan Schneider, and I'm a pharmacist. I can almost remember every piece of my life. I have hundreds of hours from wiretapping phone conversations about what happened to me. My son was murdered, buying crack. The police have the attitude that these kids maybe got what they deserved. But I was determined to get the killer off the street. If the police wasn't going to do it, I was going to do it. At first, my mission was to get justice for my son. But then I started noticing in the drugstore a lot of kids around my son's age coming in with high-powered opiate prescriptions for OxyContin.
Word on the street was it's just heroin and a pill.
There was a certain doctor using her license to virtually decimate my community. I couldn't look the other way.
There was a rumor that it was a pharmacist making a lot of noise, and that's not good for business.
I had questions all the time. Why aren't you doing this? Why aren't you doing that?
There were boxes and boxes of materials.
All right, Dan. Would that be recorded again, homie?
No.
The FBI was neither incompetent or in cahoots.
I just knew that people were making money.
If there ever was a smoking gun, that was it.
I am being followed.
You sounded crazy.
I think they waving a gun at me.
Well, God, and hopefully anybody else who hears this, because I'm losing it.
I saw this opiate epidemic in its infancy. I'm not going to let this drug continue to kill.
Get a chance to watch that documentary. I cannot recommend it enough. It's excellent. Incidentally, this is a website that you can go and type in any doctor's name, including your doctor, and see how much, if any, in terms of consulting payments or promotional payments they receive from the drug companies, just to check on, you know, how influenced they may or may not be by the drug companies. The biggest problem that we have to wrestle with when it comes to pharmaceuticals is that while other countries will regulate how much it can cost, as you read in the Journal of the American Medical Association piece, the United States doesn't, by and large, regulate prices. So the price of many pharmaceuticals will rise to as much as the market will bear. If you want to distill that whole article to its takeaway message, it's that drug companies, especially for drugs that are not generic yet, so they're under patent protection and they're trying to recoup their investment and make money, can pretty much charge what they want. There's no real limit to them. Here's a video that tries to explain how drug pricing works. It's about the best you can find.
You might think the process that determines how much you pay for something is pretty straightforward. And it often is. For example, here's the supply chain for a beverage you might buy at the drugstore. Say, a Pepsi. PepsiCo manufactures the soda and sends it to a retailer who sells it to a customer. The customer pays the retailer and the retailer pays PepsiCo. Simple, right? Well, that is not the case for the products behind the pharmacy counter, the drugs. Here's a typical supply chain for prescription drugs. It looks really different. That's because the way that drugs are priced is not at all a straightforward process. Experts and politicians argue that the very complexity of this chain is part of why drug prices have grown so high for customers.
Everyone involved in the broken system, the drug makers, insurance companies, distributors, pharmacy benefit managers, and many others contribute to the problem.
To understand this debate, first you should understand the flow of drugs and money within this chain. Let's start here with the pharmaceutical companies. They're the ones who develop a drug and set a price, known as the list price. This isn't as straightforward as it might look, which we'll explain in a moment. Next, you have the wholesalers who transport the drugs and sell them to the pharmacies. The patient pays the copay, and the pharmacy sends out a bill that gets paid by the insurance company. That's simple enough, but we're missing a link, the link that manages this transaction and adds a lot of complexity to the chain. Meet the pharmacy benefit managers, or PBMs. They're who the drug companies and some politicians are talking about when they refer to middlemen. They work for insurance companies, big employers, and government agencies. And a big part of their job is to bring down the cost of drugs for their employers. They do this by negotiating with pharmaceutical companies for rebates. Yep, for many of the drugs a pharmaceutical company sells, it pays a rebate to the PBM. The PBM sometimes pockets a portion of the rebate and passes another portion on to the insurance company or employer. Why the pharmaceutical company pays these rebates is the source of a lot of controversy. What happens is the drug company gets moved up on something called a formulary. So, what's a formulary? It's the list of drugs that the insurance company covers, and it's grouped in tiers. Each tier represents what portion of the list price the patient pays and what portion of the list price the insurance company pays. The highest tier in the formulary is the lowest copay for the patient, and the lowest tier is the highest copay for the patient. When the pharmaceutical company pays a higher rebate, the PBM will move the drug up on the formulary. Pharmaceutical companies want high placement on the formulary. That's because patients are more likely to take the drug that's most affordable, and that usually means higher sales for the pharmaceutical company. If a patient wants to take a drug that's lower down on the formulary, or not on it at all, they have to pay higher copays, or even the full list price of the drug. If this seems confusing, that's because it is. Let's take another walk through that transaction, this time with an example. Say a hypothetical drug costs $100. A PBM negotiates a $50 rebate, $10 of which they pocket, and $40 of which they pass on to the insurance company or employer. In return for that rebate, the PBM moves the drug to a better spot on the formulary, making it cheaper for the patient to buy the drug. This transaction is important because the pharmaceutical companies say it's a big reason they keep raising the price of drugs. You've probably seen a chart like this before. It's the rise in the price of a drug in the US, in this case, Humalog, according to its maker, Eli Lilly. The pharmaceutical companies say they have to raise list prices to protect their sales and profits from the demands of these higher rebates. Here's the CEO of the pharmaceutical company Merck at a hearing on drug prices.
If you bring a product to the market with a low list price in this system, you get punished financially and you get no uptake because everyone in the supply chain makes money as a result of a higher list price.
And here's that Humalog chart again, this time with the net price, or the average revenue that Eli Lilly says they take in under this system. For their part, the PBMs say the drug companies don't have to raise prices to boost their bottom lines, and that rebates reduce the cost of drugs, not inflates them. They say rebates reduce the real cost of prescription drugs because they lower the price that insurance companies pay. That helps the insurers lower the premiums that the patients have to pay for their plans. Here's Derica Rice, an executive vice president at CVS Caremark, one of the pharmacy benefit managers.
Our job is to work with the employers, unions, and government programs we serve to ensure that when their members get to the pharmacy counter, they get the medicines that they need at the lowest possible cost.
So, what does all of this mean for the patient back at the pharmacy counter? At the heart of all this is that what the patient pays is often based on the list price, not the price the insurance company is responsible for after the rebates. And patients who don't have insurance or coinsurance, or who have really high deductibles, sometimes pay the entire list price. It's important to know that the details surrounding rebates are shrouded in mystery. Pharmaceutical companies and PBMs don't release their rebate data, saying it's proprietary. But it's clear that different people and different insurance companies pay different prices for the same drugs. As you can see, the way that prices work behind the counter is totally different from how they work in front.
Is that all clear now? Oh, I've watched this many times. I've read the JAMA article many times. I sort of understand it. The problem is all of those figures that any of them are shown to you are all proprietary. As they say, they all come straight from the pharmaceutical benefit manufacturers or the drug companies. They're not independently verified. Who knows if any of those claims are true? But we know that in the end that the system is almost intentionally opaque and complicated, because that's what works best for all of the stakeholders in that system. So if you're struggling, even after all this, to understand what drives the actual pricing, you're right. I mean, there isn't a standardized, transparent, rational approach to drug pricing. It's what the market will bear, with all of these intermediaries sort of working for you, but sort of working for themselves. And the government not really playing much of a role. Every other country, they deal with this. They deal with it in different ways. They understand, as you can look at this economics chart, the quantity of the drug that's sold, a lot or none, is partly a function of the price of the drug. If you set the price super high, so high that nobody can afford it, the quantity will be zero. So somewhere along unaffordable and zero, where you lose money, is where drug prices are set. Most drug companies want to set the price higher, a monopoly price, so they can make more. And you can't ask drug companies to sell any drug for less than the marginal cost to produce it, because they'll lose money. So there's no point in that. They won't be a drug company there if you make them sell at a loss. So somewhere between a really high monopoly price and a loss-making price, there's an equilibrium. Somewhere in there is a price at which they can make a profit, but then you could actually have more people afford it. What other countries do is they put a control price, a cap price, negotiated by competition or by consensus through pharmacists and economists and clinicians. It's always lower than what the drug companies want, but it's higher than the marginal cost, and a lower control price still allows for profit, but more people can afford it and you can have more quantity sold. And what drug companies also know is that if you force them to sell way, way down towards the marginal cost, they will lose money, and there's no point in that. But if you just make them go from $10 a pill to $8 a pill, in the end, they'll still make just about the same amount of money, because they'll sell more of it. They'll have a greater quantity at a slightly lower price. And that's what price controls do in other countries. We don't do that in this country, because there's no countervailing force that pushes back on the monopoly price. But other countries do that. Or what another option is you can use a mathematical formula, often known as QALYs or DALYs, quality adjusted life years or disability adjusted life years. It's really complicated. And if the whole class was on pharmaceuticals, we could actually break this out over several classes and explain it. But let me just say in a nutshell, it actually prices the quality of a life at about $30,000 to $50,000 per year. So a lifetime is multiple millions. A human life with quality is worth $6-7 million. And so that if you are going to extend the quality of life or the quantity of life, it actually breaks out to about, the actual worth of doing that is about $50,000 a year. And an example is that we watched on the class on dying, the drug Avastin to treat breast cancer. Scientific studies have shown that it extends the life of advanced breast cancer patients about 6 weeks to 6 months, closer to 6 weeks, and it costs $40,000. So under this formula that's used in most countries, they would not pay for that, because that's not enough time. You would need to extend the life by at least a year to justify paying $40,000. Let me show you a very, very quick synopsis of how they try to explain this. And the way I would just try to understand it is that saying, if you don't put any limits, then any drug that extends life at all or does any quality enhancement would be paid for. And that's currently what the US model is. Other countries say, no, we have to have some way, shape, or form of saying that a drug, any kind of drug, is.
Amelia Preda has joined the meeting.
Value is a unit called qualies, or quality adjusted life years. One quality is equal to living for 1 year in perfect health. So how do we work this out? Well, what we do is we look at the average person with a specific disease, and then we look at all the outcomes of that disease, both with and without the intervention that we are evaluating. For each possible outcome, we assign a probability and a utility score. The utility score is a measure of how much your quality of life would decrease with a certain outcome. For example, someone with wet macular degeneration might say that if they went blind, their quality of life would decrease by 55%. This would mean a utility score of 0.45. Using a mathematical model called a Markov model, we combine the utility scores and probabilities and other factors to determine the average benefit to someone with a disease who takes the drug which we are evaluating. We calculate that benefit over the course of the treatment and end up with the increase in qualities caused by the drug. The next thing we do is look at the cost to society as a result of each outcome. Most obviously, we have to look at the cost of paying for the drug treatments, but then we also have to take into account the total cost of each possible outcome associated with both receiving the treatment and not receiving the treatment. For example, in eye care, we also have to consider the cost to the healthcare system if a patient went blind, including personal assistance, patient education, and continuing medical care. In this case, the blindness could have been caused by an adverse effect from the drug or through not taking the drug at all. Once we have determined the cost, we can then calculate the cost per quality, or how much does it cost us to gain the equivalent of a year in perfect health for a patient. This cost per quality becomes a standardized metric to evaluate new interventions. The typical scenario is that a new intervention provides an improvement in either the length or quality of life, but costs money. And health economists and doctors argue it out as to whether the government should pay for the intervention. Most governments fund things that cost less than $50,000 per quality and do not pay for others that are more costly. It is a complex analysis, and we've only brushed on its surface, but I hope that we've been able to give you a small glimpse into how health economists work and how their analyses help us to run our healthcare system with a reasoned approach.
As you can imagine, with any kind of formula, people argue over how much quality has been enhanced, you know, what constitutes a worthwhile cut point at 30,000 a year quality or 40,000. And reasonable people can disagree about that. But the value of coming up with an equation is that it's transparent and you can adjust the different components of it. You can say, no, we want to cover more things. You know, we're willing to spend more money. Or if you're in a time of austerity and you're trying to fight a pandemic, you can say, no, we have at this point in time, we have a crisis and we have to pay for more ventilators just to keep people alive. So we're not going to do other drugs that improve the quality of life. We're going to invest our limited resources and money in things that save people's life. So we'll spend more on insulin, more on vaccine development to fight the coronavirus. And we'll do less on other things that are not as life-threatening. It just gives you a formula to make it more rational. Other countries have their own mechanisms. We've already talked about Australia, how they negotiate for the whole country. In the Netherlands and Germany, drug companies cannot charge more for drugs that don't offer more benefits. So you can come up with a new drug, but if it's not any more effective than the older, more affordable, cheaper drug, then you don't get to sell that drug for an inflated cost. You have to go with the equally effective, cheaper drug. In France, drug prices are sometimes based on the volume of prescriptions. If the use of a drug goes up one year, they lower the price of it next year to offset that. Maybe the standard example of why there needs to be increased rationality in pharmaceutical pricing is insulin. And we've talked about this in the week before spring break. Insulin was discovered in 1921 in Canada. It's long past the point where it should be generic and very, very affordable. But in the United States, the one exception, the price of insulin has been going up and up and up inexorably to the point where more and more people who have type 1 diabetes, like Alex we talked about last class, can't afford it. And it's not been unusual for patients who have type 1 diabetes to be facing monthly insulin costs of $1,000 or more. And that's expensive for people who have jobs and insurance, and it's still expensive. For people who are living paycheck to paycheck. And like Alex, he was making $35,000 a year as a restaurant manager and couldn't afford his $450 a month health insurance cost with a $7,000 out-of-pocket deductible. And then he ages out of his parents' plan. He has no insurance. He can't afford $1,300 a month. You start rationing. And then in many cases, tragically, people like this die. I mean, insulin is something they have to have. A similar case that thankfully did not end in death was a woman who was just like many parents or anyone trying to afford a drug that gets more expensive. She has a daughter who has type 1 diabetes. She was able to just buy two vials of insulin at $524 with a discount card. And she just tweeted this. Just that she sat in her car and was just so frustrated and so emotionally drained, she just cried and just tweeted out her frustration. And then it went viral. And people did a GoFundMe page and people poured out all these resources. And then she had to get back on Twitter to say, I was just venting. I'm overwhelmed with suggestions. Thank you. I don't really know how Twitter works, like me. We're going to figure out something to do. And then she did a GoFundMe page. You guys can go link. You can actually click on this and go to this website. It's now closed. She raised enough money to pay for the insulin. But I just include this, and other people have included this to say, this is what happens if you don't have some regulation and some standardization of pharmaceutical costs, that if just left to the market, drug companies that have almost a monopoly or at least an oligopoly, like three companies make insulin, this is what can happen if you don't have some pushback. And if you guys want to watch it, I encourage you to watch this episode of Patriot Act on drug pricing, because it's done with even more entertainment value and good graphics. And it, in the end, he highlights, you know, there's different ways you can go about this. And if, you know, I don't know how much you all know Martin Shkreli. He's like the poster child for just unchecked greed and lack of empathy. But he's the kind of example of what you can get away with in the U.S. His, you know, he used to run hedge funds, and then he went into buying drugs that that certain populations need. And he would buy the one company that made this generic drug and take a generic drug that was $5, $10 a pill that was affordable, and he'd raise it 5,000% to $750 just because he could. And he became one of the most hated men in America and ended up going to jail for 7 years, not for price gouging of pharmaceuticals. It was for an unrelated case of hedge fund mismanagement and just stealing. But it wasn't the abuse of drug costs that sent him to jail. It was something else. And for a lot of people, they thought he should have gone to jail for raising the drug, raising the price of a drug that people needed to live. I don't want to end class or this lecture on a depressing note. I want to end it on a really encouraging note, which is Virginia is, to my knowledge, the first state that has passed a insulin cap price of $50 a month for insulin. And Victoria mentioned this at the end of the class before spring break, and I was shocked in class. I didn't even know they were doing this. And I'm so proud of our state, and I'm so proud of this example of good public policy, that you can just say, look, $50 is the cap. And after that, the drug company has to sell it still at a profit, but not at an extortionate profit. Or the insurance company has to pay more for it. But it puts a limit on a generic drug that people have to live. So I want to end this class and this lecture with a note of encouragement that this is possible. Other countries do it. And Virginia is now just an example to the other 49 states that there are ways that you can still allow drug companies to make a profit, but you can definitely limit the price pain that patients face. Thank you guys for listening, and thanks for your patience as I get better at this. Take care, and I'll see you next week.
You have stopped screen share.